Hello, good afternoon. I'm Gina Galia, a journalist at the Jakarta Post. Welcome everyone, and thank you very much for attending JakPost Up Close. This is our 11th webinar, and I'll be your MC of the day. Our topic today is human capital development and Indonesia's 2045 vision. We have hundreds of people joining us this afternoon. We are honored to be able to discuss with Presidential Chief of Staff Pak Muldoko about the opportunities and challenges of the nation's human capital development. As we all know, President Joko Widodo has a big vision for Indonesia's 100th year of independence in 2045, in which the goal is to be a developed country with an annual income of 320 million rupiah per capita or a monthly income of 27 rupiah million per capita. Therefore, human capital development is central to that effort. I would like to apologize because the talk show is not live, but pre-recorded. We recorded the interview about a week ago. However, I hope and I believe that it will not decrease our enthusiasm to discuss about Indonesia's human capital development this afternoon. So before we start, I would like to explain our agenda today. The 1 hour talk show with Pak Muldoko was conducted by the Post Editor-in-Chief, Nezar Patria, or Bang Nezar. After we air the talk show, we will have a quick break, and then we will start the panel session with 4 distinguished speakers, which will be moderated by my senior editor, Andy Bayuni. And of course, good journalism needs your support. If you want the Jakarta Post to contribute more to public discourse, subscribe today on thejakartapost.com/packages. It costs only 50,000 rupiah per month, and you can pay it with GoPay. So once again, thank you for participating in our webinar. Without further ado, we will now start airing the talk show. Please enjoy.
Ya, selamat sore Pak Muldoko. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam, Pak Nizar. Selamat sore.
Ya, ya. Ya, cerah sekali Pak. Apa hari ini ya, Pak ya? Kebetulan kita masih dalam suasana merayakan hari ulang tahun Republik Indonesia yang ke-75. Ya tentu saja usia yang sangat patut kita syukuri sebagai bangsa Indonesia, Pak Muldoko kan. Dalam bincang-bincang dengan Jakarta Post pada sore ini, kita akan coba eksplorasi seputar pencapaian Republik kita tercinta ini selama 75 tahun terakhir. Nah, Pak Muldoko, selama 75 tahun Republik Indonesia berdiri, kita tahu ada banyak momen-momen penting ya yang kita lewati, dan juga sejumlah krisis yang alhamdulillah bisa kita lewati dengan baik juga, tapi tentu saja dengan sejumlah pekerjaan rumah yang harus kita selesaikan. Menurut Pak Muldoko, apa pencapaian terpenting kita sebagai bangsa dan negara selama 75 tahun merdeka, Pak?
Ya, terima kasih Mas Nizar. Kalau kita melihat pencapaian Indonesia dalam kurun 75 tahun ini adalah satu hal yang sangat-sangat penting, yaitu bangsa ini tetap utuh dan bertumbuh semakin baik. Itu kunci ya. Kita bisa melihat perkembangan historikalnya, historik dari Indonesia. Gimana pada saat zamannya Pak Soekarno, kondisi dalam negeri selalu bergolak ya, dalam situasi setelah kemerdekaan terus sampai dengan 65. Bapak Soekarno selalu menghadapi situasi dalam negeri yang tidak baik ya, khususnya dari stabilitas politik dan keamanan, sehingga aspek ekonominya menjadi terganggu pertumbuhannya. Berikutnya setelah itu zaman Pak Harto melihat situasi seperti itu, maka pertumbuhan ditingkatkan, pendekatannya adalah ekonomi. Ada waktu istilah ekonomi sebagai panglima. Dengan trilogi pembangunan, Pak Harto melakukan bagaimana membangun stabilitas. Berikutnya pertumbuhan ekonomi dan pemerataan ya. Untuk menjaga stabilitas dari situasi yang 65 dan seterusnya, itu adalah situasi yang juga tidak baik kondisinya, maka stabilitas menjadi porsi yang utama. Untuk itulah Pak Presiden waktu itu Pak Harto menempatkan TNI untuk mengemban fungsi di luar pertahanan. Akhirnya muncullah konsep dwi fungsi ABRI. Dwi fungsi ABRI telah mengalami perkembangan yang eksesif, akhirnya mendapatkan koreksi pada Orde Reformasi. Orde Reformasi menempatkan politik sebagai panglima. Akhirnya persoalan ekonomi juga perlu dipikirkan. Dalam perkembangannya setelah reformasi, kita merenung ya, sebenarnya mana yang paling tepat bagi Indonesia ini. Apakah menempatkan politik sebagai panglima, apakah ekonomi sebagai panglima. Maka saya pikir sekarang ini adalah sebuah momentum yang tepat bagaimana menempatkan antara politik dan ekonomi menjadi balancing sehingga semuanya bertumbuh dengan baik. Setelah reformasi, banyak pengamat-pengamat luar negeri yang mengatakan bahwa Indonesia akan runtuh, Indonesia akan pecah, dan seterusnya. Dan alhamdulillah, sebuah pencapaian prestasi Indonesia yang luar biasa sampai saat ini, itu Indonesia tetap utuh dan bertumbuh dengan baik. Kalau saya melihat bagaimana proses sejarah ini, saya proyeksikan dengan kondisi yang saya hadapi. Ya. Pada tahun-tahun saya bertumbuh tahun 65, di mana memang kami menghadapi situasi yang sangat sulit. Pada saat itu saya keluarga harus makan burger ya, yang itu bahan bakunya mie instan itu ya. Itu ya. Dulu menjadi makanan, menjadi beras sangat sulit ya. Minyak antri minyak saya hampir 3 hari sekali disuruh ibu saya antri minyak begitu cukup panjang begitu, pagi-pagi begitu. Situasi ekonomi cukup sulit waktu itu, ya. Dan menghadapi sekolah juga tidak mudah. Tapi sekarang ini kalau kita melihat sekarang perkembangannya sungguh luar biasa, ya, sungguh luar biasa. Berikutnya perkembangan politik kalau saya melihat pada tahun 96-97 pada saat saya jadi Komandan Kodim, mungkin saya punya pandangan yang sangat berbeda dengan Mas Nizar. Kita sering bertemu di jalanan. Nah, sekarang kita bisa diskusi dengan nyaman. Ini sebuah perkembangan situasi politik yang luar biasa ya, yang luar biasa. Mungkin pada saat itu tidak terbayangkan ya akan terjadi perubahan-perubahan yang signifikan begitu. Itu perubahan-perubahan situasi politik yang kita hadapi dan situasi kondisi ekonomi yang kita hadapi bersama. Dan yang sangat membanggakan bagi bangsa Indonesia saat ini adalah tingkat pencapaian yang dijalankan oleh Pak Jokowi ya dengan pendekatan Indonesia sentris, maka pembangunan menuju kepada pembangunan yang berkeadilan dan berkesejahteraan sungguh betul-betul terasa saat ini. Kita tidak lagi mengenal Jawa sentris, tidak mengenal lagi ini sentris dan seterusnya. Yang dikenalkan saat ini adalah membangun Indonesia sentris, di mana menuju kepada betul-betul pembangunan yang berkeadilan dan berkesejahteraan. Ini bisa dilihat dari bagaimana Pak Jokowi membangun infrastruktur ya. Kalau perkembangan infrastruktur sampai dengan 2014 kita hanya 795 km jalan tol, maka zamannya saat ini pembangunan infrastruktur yang dikelola oleh Pak Jokowi ini sudah menunjukkan luar biasa ya. Sudah kurang lebih 1280 sekian kilometer ya. Nah, ini 1.298 km ya. Ini bukan persoalan yang mudah, tetapi kita semuanya menikmati itu dengan baik ya. Sebuah pencapaian yang tadinya tidak terbayangkan bahwa kita sekarang ini naik mobil ke Jawa itu dalam tempo cukup sangat singkat ya. Berikutnya kita tidak pernah membayangkan bahwa ada harga BBM di Papua itu sama dengan di Jawa. Yang itu sebuah proses yang tidak mudah. Tidak mudah, betul-betul tidak mudah. Saya sering bertugas di perbatasan ya. Kalau saya mengatakan kondisi orang-orang perbatasan, selalu mengatakan bahwa negara tidak hadir di tengah-tengah kami. Tapi negara hanya datang, pejabatnya datang, saya tuh melihat situasi seolah-olah dengan kedatangan mereka itu semua urusan selesai. Tetapi persoalan-persoalan mendasar berkaitan dengan pendidikan, berkaitan dengan kesehatan, berkaitan dengan aspek-aspek sosial yang lain itu belum tertangani dengan baik. Untuk itulah saya mengatakan bahwa pembangunan infrastruktur bukan sekedar pembangunan fisik belaka, tapi justru pembangunan infrastruktur adalah pembangunan peradaban manusia. Karena dengan terkoneksikannya infrastruktur itu, maka kemudahan-kemudahan pada sisi kesehatan, sisi ekonomi, sisi pendidikan, dan yang lain-lain sungguh tersedia dengan baik. Dan disitulah kita dikenalkan dengan peradaban-peradaban baru. Di antaranya pembangunan LRT, ini juga sebuah peradaban. Yang tadinya orang masuk kereta dengan berduyun-duyun atau tidak mau antri. Tapi sekarang, mohon maaf, Anda tidak antri, Anda tidak akan dapat tempat. Nah, inilah di antaranya bahwa semua itu tidak cukup dimengerti bahwa pembangunan infrastruktur adalah sebuah pembangunan fisik, tapi pembangunan peradaban manusia di dalam. Itu tingkat-tingkat pencapaian yang menurut saya intinya adalah Indonesia tetap utuh dan bertumbuh dengan baik. Nah, itu.
Ya, Pak Muldoko, saya kira itu pencapaian yang sangat patut kita syukuri ya. Saya pernah bincang-bincang dengan mantan Menteri Pertahanan kita sebelumnya, Pak Juwono Sudarsono. Saya bertanya, kenapa sebetulnya kita bisa bertahan sebagai bangsa waktu itu lebih dari 60 tahun? Gitu. Dan jawaban Pak Juwono cukup mengejutkan saya. Beliau mengatakan bahwa kita bisa bersama karena mukjizat, katanya begitu. Mukjizat, karena mengingat begitu beragamnya bangsa Indonesia ya, etnis, agama, juga berbagai macam kelompok-kelompok yang ada di dalam masyarakat. Nah, tapi kita bisa duduk bersama dan berdiri sebagai salah satu bangsa yang terbesar di Asia Tenggara pada hari ini. Tadi saya setuju sekali Pak Muldoko menyebutkan salah satu yang bisa kita catat setelah reformasi adalah pembangunan ekonomi yang sedang dirintis oleh Presiden Jokowi saat ini. Dan juga kita sudah melihat bagaimana pencapaian-pencapaian dan pembangunan fisik dalam wujud infrastruktur. Dan cukup patut dicatat juga bahwa sekarang bukan lagi Jawa sentris pembangunannya, tetapi Indonesia sentris. Saya kira itu salah satu lompatan yang penting juga untuk jalan kita ke masa depan. Nah, mungkin bisa di elaborasi lebih lanjut Pak Muldoko, kira-kira hal paling mendasar yang harus kita selesaikan dalam 25 tahun ke depan Pak.
Ya, hal mendasar yang perlu kita arahkan ke depan ya, menurut saya begini, Indonesia ke depan harus menjadi sebuah kekuatan baru, hemisfer baru di Asia. Kalau kita mengenal di tengah-tengah pertumbuhan Amerika, China, dan India, maka kami yakin ya, Indonesia dengan projection populasi yang kira-kira pada tahun 2045 itu mencapai 3.018 juta ya, 318 juta. Ini sebuah kekuatan yang luar biasa ya, sebuah kekuatan yang luar biasa. Berikutnya, kita memiliki sebuah potensi yang bisa digerakkan menjadi kekuatan. Potensi-potensi yang kita miliki adalah potensi sumber daya manusia. Kalau potensi yang lain juga yang bisa digerakkan menjadi kekuatan dan saat ini sudah ada di tengah-tengah kita adalah sumber daya alamnya, sumber daya buatan. Sumber daya buatan adalah seluruh sumber daya yang telah dibangun oleh para pemimpin negara sebelumnya dan sampai dengan saat ini. Sedangkan sumber daya alam adalah sumber daya alam yang diberikan oleh Tuhan yang patut kita kelola bersama. Tapi kita juga paham bahwa kemampuan sumber daya alam dari waktu ke waktu akan berkurang dengan cukup signifikan. Maka kita tidak cukup mengandalkan pembangunan sumber daya alam dengan pendekatan based resources. Tapi knowledge based adalah sebuah pendekatan yang sangat arif dan bijaksana ke depan. Nah, saya ingin mengilustrasikan ya bahwa kekuatan populasi Indonesia pada bonus demografi ke depan sebenarnya 2045 kita memiliki kurang lebih 30 anak-anak yang produktif pada masanya ya. Terus yang kedua, sekarang ini kita juga sedang menyusun grand design untuk manajemen sumber daya, manajemen talenta nasional. Maka saya meyakini bahwa kelompok-kelompok itulah yang nanti menjadi core mover Indonesia. Bisa dibayangkan, kalau orang-orang ini nanti terkelola dengan baik, maka melalui mereka lah Indonesia akan digerakkan dan bergerak dengan cepat. Apalagi kita memiliki apa itu kekuatan pasar dalam negeri yang cukup besar ya jumlahnya. Nah, berikutnya memperdomani dari empat mimpi besar yang disampaikan oleh Pak Jokowi ya pada visi 2045. Yang pertama adalah menjadi negara maju dengan pendapatan 320 juta per kapita ya. Berarti 27 juta per kapita per bulannya. Berikutnya PDB Indonesia mencapai 7 triliun dolar Amerika dan kita akan masuk 5 besar pemain ekonomi dunia. Berikutnya kita menginginkan kemiskinan mendekati 0%, maka betul-betul Indonesia ke depan menjadi sebuah kekuatan baru yang diperhitungkan di kawasan Asia.
Ya, menarik sekali Pak Muldoko. Tadi kita sempat menyinggung soal bonus demografi dan rasanya itu tidak lama lagi akan kita alami ya, semacam ada ledakan tenaga produktif yang ada di Republik ini, usia muda yang menempati posisi yang dominan di tengah masyarakat, usia muda yang produktif. Ada juga sejumlah masalah kalau kita melihat kondisi saat ini, terutama dalam rangka kita menyiapkan generasi baru ini nanti untuk apa di masa depan, sehingga bonus demografi itu betul-betul bisa kita petik manfaatnya seperti yang diharapkan. Tapi sementara itu kita menghadapi sejumlah soal ya, penyiapan sumber daya manusia gitu. Yang pertama misalnya soal kesehatan ya Pak. Kita masih punya problem dengan stunting dan lain sebagainya macamnya di sejumlah daerah di luar Jawa. Dan juga kita masih punya persoalan dengan peningkatan skill terhadap tenaga produktif kita. Kira-kira apa yang dipersiapkan dalam tempo 5 tahun ke depan gitu Pak, untuk kita bisa naik levelnya lebih baik ketika bonus demografi itu tiba gitu Pak?
Ya, kalau kita berbicara indeks pembangunan manusia yang harus meningkat dari waktu ke waktu, maka yang pertama memang kita berbicara tentang kesehatan ya. Kita masih menghadapi persoalan kesehatan. Yang pertama adalah apa itu angka kematian ibu dan angka kematian anak. Tetapi kita juga membuat projection pada 2024 nanti kita harus menuju kepada angka kematian ibu dan anak yang semakin menyempit ya. Itu proyeksinya ada 21 per 1000 ya tingkat kematiannya. Berikutnya kalau kita melihat stunting RPJMN juga menuju kepada 14 ya. 14% kita pada 2024 nanti. Sekarang ini kita masih di posisi 24%. Tapi Presiden Jokowi mengatakan kita harus genjot untuk segera menuju ke angka 17%. Itu sebuah angka-angka progresif yang diinginkan oleh Presiden sehingga angka stunting itu tidak menjadi persoalan yang mengganggu bagi pertumbuhan anak kita ke depan. Karena kita yakini bersama dengan munculnya stunting maka itu mau tidak mau akan menjadi beban kepada orang tuanya dan menjadi beban bagi negara. Untuk itulah stunting menjadi gerakan nasional saat ini. Ya. Stunting tidak saja dijalankan oleh pemerintah pusat, tapi secara masif para pimpinan daerah telah menjalankan program anti-stunting ini dengan sungguh-sungguh. Ya. Pendekatannya adalah bagaimana memberikan protein lokal ya sampai dengan bagaimana memikirkan makanan-makanan lokal itu bagi upaya menghilangkan stunting. Ya. Berikutnya, program-program yang dijalankan oleh pemerintah diantaranya program Keluarga Harapan. Ya. Program Keluarga Harapan yang tadinya 9,4 juta menjadi 10 juta. Yang tadinya 120 ribu per bulan menjadi 200 ribu per bulan. Ini juga sebuah upaya. Sampai-sampai dalam rapat ke apa itu tingkat menteri kita berpikir. Ya. Karena program keluarga apa itu PKH itu ditentukan. Ini sebuah program yang ditujukan khusus untuk perbaikan gizi. Khusus untuk perbaikan gizi. Sampai-sampai waktu itu kita diskusikan tempe dan tahu masuk boleh masuk enggak dalam apa itu belanja ibu-ibu untuk ke sana. Itu pun menjadi perdebatan dalam sidang tingkat menteri ya waktu itu. Nah, begitu begitu sungguh-sungguhnya lah kita pemerintah telah menjalani apa melaksanakan program bagaimana anti stunting dan penurunan tingkat kematian ibu dan anak. Itu betul-betul menjadi prioritas ya. Berikutnya angka harapan hidup ya. Angka harapan hidup kita cukup baik perkembangannya ya. Cukup bagus ya. Kalau kita melihat dari waktu ke waktu telah bertumbuh cukup bagus ya. Saya pikir ini sebuah indikator bahwa kita sedang menuju ke sana. Saya yakin nanti pada 2045 tingkat harapan hidup orang Indonesia itu diproyeksi 71 ya untuk laki-laki dan 84,86 untuk perempuan. Itu kira sekitar 75 lah untuk perempuannya. Jadi maknanya apa? Maknanya ada sebuah indikator yang menunjukkan ke arah sana. Jadi memang pembangunan sumber daya manusia itu betul-betul dibenahi mulai dari 1000 hari anak dalam kandungan sampai dengan dia lahir. Karena itu adalah golden age dan presiden sangat concern atas hal itu. Dan saya yakin ya, saya yakin ke depan apa yang diproyeksikan kita betul-betul bisa terlaksana dengan baik.
Ya, Pak Mudoko. 75 tahun Republik Indonesia, kita juga menghadapi cobaan yang cukup berat. Ya, bukan kita sendiri sebagai bangsa, tapi juga dunia, saya kira secara global, menghadapi pandemi virus COVID-19 ini. Kita rasanya benar-benar diuji dari segala sudut ya, baik ketahanan ekonomi kita, sosial, dan juga pencapaian-pencapaian kesehatan yang sudah kita dapatkan selama kita merdeka. Dan ini diuji dengan wabah yang cukup serius sekarang yang lagi kita hadapi. Kira-kira pelajaran penting apa, Pak, yang bisa kita petik dalam perjalanan untuk mengatasi pandemi ini? Pandemi belum selesai, jelas. Masih ada beberapa tahapan yang akan menghadang kita di depan, tetapi setidaknya setelah 6 bulan kurang lebih ya kita bergumul dan berjuang untuk menekan angka infeksi ini, apa catatan-catatan Pak Muldoko, pencapaian-pencapaian yang bisa kita catat?
Ya, yang saya melihat karena di KSP ini salah satu fungsinya adalah bagaimana melakukan monitor dan evaluasi. Secara pribadi saya melihat bahwa perkembangan masyarakat Indonesia menuju hal yang bagus ya. Ada sebuah fenomena baru di mana meningkatnya social awareness ya. Dan ini betul-betul nantinya bisa digunakan sebagai social capital untuk pembangunan bangsa ke depan ya. Apa itu social awareness yang muncul atau social capital yang bisa kita eksploitasi ke depan? Yang pertama adalah gotong royong ya. Tadinya kita cukup was-was bahwa gotong royong kita mulai menipis dan ego masing-masing meningkat, tetapi alhamdulillah dengan COVID ini ya, tingkat gotong royong masyarakat itu sungguh luar biasa. Di berbagai komunitas, di berbagai perkumpulan-perkumpulan itu gotong royong itu terbangun dengan baik ya, terbangun dengan baik. Berikutnya adalah ada upaya yang pantang menyerah ya, sehingga memunculkan kemandirian. Yang tadinya kita persoalan ventilator menjadi persoalan yang krusial, tapi dengan COVID ini semuanya ternyata bisa kita bikin, nggak sulit-sulit amat begitu. Berikutnya persoalan soliditas juga terbangun cukup bagus ya. Ini soliditas sebagai modal untuk menyatukan ya, menyatukan apa visi bersama. Kalau nggak sulit maka menuju kepada visi yang telah disepakati menjadi sulit. Ya, alhamdulillah, soliditas telah terbangun dengan baik, sehingga kohesivitas juga demikian, yang pada akhirnya apa? Yang pada akhirnya resiliensi telah terbangun. Ketahanan nasional telah terbangun dengan baik. Ini tidak mudah, ya, tidak mudah. Tapi COVID telah membawa hikmah ya, membawa hikmah ke sana, telah membawa hikmah ke sana ya. Berikutnya, dari COVID ini juga kita perlu ada upaya recovery, reformasi, dan juga transformasi. Ya. Recovery, persoalan ekonomi, kita perlu segera recovery dengan cepat. Karena kalau tidak, maka persoalan yang dihadapi masyarakat, pengusaha kita juga akan repot ke depan. Untuk itulah, di dalam menghadapi COVID ini ada 3 strategi besar yang dijalankan oleh pemerintah. Ya, yang selalu dikatakan di mana-mana, yang pertama adalah pendekatan kesehatan. Masyarakat ditekan semaksimal mungkin, jangan sampai ada korban sebanyak-banyaknya. Harus ditekan semaksimal mungkin, jangan sampai masyarakat menjadi korban. Dengan segala upaya, pemerintah telah menjalankan dengan segala upaya. Yang kedua, agar masyarakat tetap bisa makan dengan baik. Untuk itulah pemerintah telah menggelontorkan sejumlah jaring pengaman sosial dan bantuan sosial. Itu pemerintah pusat menjalankan, pemerintah daerah, provinsi dan kabupaten juga menjalankan. Berikutnya yang ketiga adalah bagaimana dunia usaha harus bisa bekerja, menjalankan fungsinya dengan baik agar persoalan PHK tidak terjadi. Untuk itulah stimulus ya dan insentif bagi dunia usaha khususnya pada UMKM dan korporasi, semuanya telah diperhatikan oleh pemerintah agar apa? Agar dunia usaha kita tetap berjalan dengan baik. Itu dari sisi recovery. Berikutnya dari sisi reformasi. Setelah kita menghadapi COVID ini, kita baru tahu salah satu contoh kita melihat bagaimana persoalan kesehatan kita. Ya, ternyata ya kalau kita melihat perbandingannya ya rasionalnya rasionya ya kita itu 10.000 orang ditangani oleh 4 dokter. Bisa dibayangkan itu ya. 4 dokter menangani 10.000 orang di Indonesia ini. Ini kan harus diperbaiki ini. Enggak boleh lagi seperti itu. Untuk itu ke depan ini sudah menjadi concern Presiden untuk segera kita melakukan reformasi di bidang kesehatan ya. Kita juga melakukan reformasi di berbagai aspek yang lain agar tingkat pelayanan menjadi mudah, sederhana, fleksibel dan seterusnya. Sehingga persoalan reformasi birokrasi juga harus dijalankan dengan baik. Berikutnya harus transformasi ya. Ini juga kita memikirkan dengan COVID ini transformasi di bidang pendidikan yang tadinya face to face sekarang dikelola melalui online. Berikutnya transformasi di bidang ekonomi juga harus dijalankan ya. Mau tidak mau dunia mengharuskan kita berada di situ. Berikutnya dari sisi transformasi ini juga kalau kita berbicara masalah transformasi ekonomi yang saat ini digalakkan oleh pemerintah yaitu bagaimana kita tidak saja mengandalkan hulunya tapi hilirnya juga harus dipikirkan dengan baik sehingga tingkat keekonomian kita menjadi tinggi dan menjadi lebih efisien. Itulah hal-hal yang bisa kita petik sebuah pelajaran dari COVID ini sehingga Indonesia betul-betul tidak saja memiliki ide, tapi juga memiliki cara-cara baru dalam mengelola ide baru itu. Itu kira-kira.
Ya Pak, menarik sekali. Terutama soal ketahanan nasional tadi Pak, resiliensi kita sebagai bangsa. Kalau Pak Muldoko lihat ya, semacam refleksi ataupun review sepanjang kita berdiri sebagai Republik 75 tahun ini, sebetulnya titik kritikal mana Pak di ketahanan nasional kita yang harus kita tingkatkan melihat perkembangan politik global saat ini Pak? Di sektor mana kira-kira yang harus kita tingkatkan?
Ya, kalau kita selalu berbicara dari aspek-aspek ya, aspek ideologi politik, sosial dan ekonomi, budaya ya. Dari sisi aspek ideologi, memang kita juga perlu mewaspadai bahwa ya, Pancasila sebagai sebuah ideologi yang terbuka, yang dinamis, maka diskursus tentang isme-isme itu, tentang ideologi tidak akan pernah berhenti. Untuk itulah penguatan ideologi Pancasila adalah sebuah keharusan di tengah-tengah situasi global yang seperti saat ini, di mana tidak ada batas lagi yang bisa dilarang orang mendiskusikan sesuatu. Maka penguatan ideologi ke dalam adalah sebuah keharusan. Menurut saya, tidak ada bangsa yang besar tanpa dilandasi sebuah ideologi yang kuat. Itu poin menurut saya. Berikutnya persoalan politik ya. Persoalan politik menurut kita ini juga perlu dipikirkan dengan baik ya. Bahwa otonomi yang saat ini berjalan, otonomi seluas-luasnya, ini juga membawa pengaruh yang cukup signifikan. Di mana pengaruh kontrol pusat atas daerah menjadi lemah. Ini juga harus dipikirkan jalan keluarnya. Berbagai regulasi-regulasi yang bertumburan antara pusat dan daerah, ini juga sebuah persoalan yang tidak mudah untuk diselesaikan. Karena ini pada akhirnya akan mengganggu apa itu iklim ekonomi, environment apa investasi kita menjadi terganggu, ya apa itu iklim dunia usaha kita. Berikutnya apa itu dari sisi politik, ya kita memang saat ini melalui pertumbuhan demokrasi kita yang luar biasa, ya indeks demokrasi kita meningkat dengan tajam. Tapi juga begini menurut saya, pemahaman tentang demokrasi juga perlu didudukkan dengan yang pada posisi yang tepat. Tidak boleh atas nama demokrasi itu menjadi semena-mena, mengklaim merasa paling benar, mengklaim paling apa dan seterusnya, tidak boleh. Karena demokrasi mendudukkan semua orang pada posisi yang egaliter, tidak boleh semena-mena dan seterusnya, tidak boleh apalagi mengganggu orang lain. Itu bertentangan dengan undang-undang, dengan regulasi, dengan konstitusi. Untuk itu pemahaman tentang demokrasi itu harus didudukkan dengan baik. Ya. Indonesia sudah masuk pada dunia apa, situasi demokrasi yang sangat cukup bagus sekarang. Tetapi benar belum tentu apa kalau orang Jawa itu pas pen, apa itu bahasa Jawa itu benar belum tentu pas lah gitu ya. Nah, kita sudah memahami bahwa demokrasi kita sudah benar, tapi harus didudukkan pada posisi yang pas, ya pas dengan kondisi apa budaya kita, pas dengan kondisi apa attitude kita sebagai orang Timur dan seterusnya dan seterusnya. Itu menurut saya catatan saya. Berikutnya dari sosial budaya, ya bahwa perkembangan kita juga memahami bahwa kalau kita melihat ada buku yang namanya Perang Kebudayaan. Ini perang kebudayaan juga harus betul-betul kita pahami dengan baik. Karena kalau tidak, maka kita menjadi sebuah bangsa yang secara tidak sadar atau sadar, kita menikmati akan kekalahan. Jadi ciri-ciri dari apa sasaran dari perang kebudayaan adalah menyenangkan korbannya. Jangan sampai kita secara tidak sadar, kita happy padahal kita menjadi orang yang menjadi korban. Nah ini. Ini juga harus dipikirkan dengan sebaik-baiknya agar kita ini betul-betul menjadi sebuah bangsa yang memiliki kekuatan di bidang ideologi, mapan dan pas di dalam menjalankan demokrasi. Ya, berikutnya dari sisi sosial dan budaya, kita jangan sampai menjadi bangsa yang terjajah dari sisi budaya. Dari sisi itu, kalau kita selalu waspada, maka kita yakin ya kita menjadi bangsa yang winner, bukan menjadi bangsa yang loser. Nah, kira-kira seperti itu.
Ya, menarik sekali Pak. Mendudukkan demokrasi dengan pas. Ini saya kira pernyataan yang sangat menantang untuk kita elaborasi lebih jauh. Ya, mendudukkan dengan pas, apakah itu bermakna kita akan mencoba mengurangi kebebasan-kebebasan yang sudah ada, atau kita membuat reformulasi Pak terhadap demokrasi Indonesia ini?
Tidak seperti itu. Mendudukkan demokrasi yang pas adalah kebebasan itu ada regulasi yang mengaturnya. Mari kita lihat simbol yang ada di Amerika, simbol liberty ya. Kalau saya ceramah selalu saya katakan, saya suatu saat ke Amerika, saya ada di bawahnya patung liberty. Saya perhatikan dengan sungguh-sungguh apa yang dipikirkan oleh orang Amerika pada saat dia membangun demokrasi. Dan tercermin dari payung apa itu patung liberty itu. Patung liberty itu ya, satu tangan dia angkat apa itu api kebebasan setinggi-tingginya, tapi pada tangan yang satunya lagi dia peluk konstitusi dengan erat. Maknanya apa? Sebab kebebasan itu tidak boleh dijalankan semena-mena, tetapi harus ada regulasi yang mengaturnya. Karena akan sulit membedakan antara anarki dan demokrasi. Tapi kalau demokrasi itu dibangun atas dasar sebuah konstitusi yang kuat, maka dia akan pas berjalannya. Nah, kira-kira seperti itu. Tapi ada sebuah teori lagi yang bagaimana membangun antara stability dan demokrasi. Ini juga tidak mudah, Mas Manisat. Saya waktu Panglima ya, Pak. Waktu Panglima mempelajari buku itu dengan baik ya. Bagaimana mendudukkan antara demokrasi dan stability. Ada sebuah buku, satu sumbu atasnya adalah stability, sumbu datarnya adalah demokrasi. Sebuah negara ya yang bisa mengelola antara stability dan demokrasi dengan baik, maka negara itu akan selamat. Tapi banyak negara yang mencoba ya mengarah kepada demokrasi yang tidak bisa dikendalikan dengan baik, negara itu runtuh dan the point of no return. Kita lihat beberapa negara di Arab, di Jazirah Arab, sebuah bukti konkret negara itu yang mencoba bergeser dari sentralistik menuju demokrasi tapi tidak bisa mengendalikan dengan baik, maka negara itu rontok dan the point of no return. Enggak ada gunanya. Kita baru sadar setelah semuanya itu rata dengan tanah. Nah, itulah ya, pada saat saya menjadi Panglima, saya mencoba bagaimana memainkan antara stability dan demokrasi dengan sebaik-baiknya. Sehingga ada istilah yang selalu saya tekankan kepada para jurid saya, TNI bermain di ruang sempit. Begitu kita menekankan atas pentingnya stabilitas, maka demokrasi akan terganggu. Tapi begitu demokrasi tidak dikawal dengan sebaik-baiknya, maka anarki akan muncul. Itu mas kira-kira sebuah teori yang tidak mudah, dan itu seni ya menangani situasi. Betul. Itu.
Ya, membuat balance antara stabilitas dengan demokrasi, saya kira menjadi salah satu seni memerintah gitu Pak, seni berkuasa ya. Ya, dan sangat menarik Pak, karena selama reformasi mungkin kita menikmati kebebasan yang cukup berlimpah dibandingkan orde sebelumnya. Itu semua kita sudah tahu apa yang terjadi di masa orde baru dan apa yang kemudian berubah di orde reformasi. Nah, ini sudah 20 tahun lebih, 22 tahun reformasi, dan ada banyak catatan juga yang diberikan kepada proses konsolidasi demokrasi yang terjadi di Republik saat ini. Dan masa ini juga sangat penting, saya kira. Jadi sama pentingnya seperti apa yang terjadi di tahun 45, sama pentingnya yang terjadi ketika Orde Baru mulai berkuasa sampai dengan 1998, dan kita menghadapi satu orde reformasi pada hari ini. Apakah mendudukkan demokrasi dengan pas itu kita membutuhkan semacam orang kuat Pak dalam memerintah atau bagaimana? Karena seringkali ada kritik terhadap demokrasi bahwa demokrasi yang berkembang sekarang ini menjadi penghalang terhadap sejumlah regulasi-regulasi yang hendak diterapkan oleh pemerintah gitu. Karena demokrasi kan kita harus menimbang banyak pendapat gitu Pak, dan pro dan kontra kadang-kadang meletihkan gitu. Menurut Bapak selama ini kita sudah cukup baik nggak belajar berdemokrasi gitu Pak?
Kalau kita melihat seperti apa sih kira-kira demokrasi kita ini dalam kondisi yang nyata di lapangannya. Yang pertama ada orang yang happy dengan demokrasi seperti ini, bahkan ada yang lebih minta lagi untuk lebih bebas lagi, ya kan begitu. Ada orang yang khawatir ya. Ada orang yang khawatir bahwa demokrasi ini akan membawa sebuah kondisi yang semakin kurang baik. Tapi ada orang yang menyesal kenapa kita berdemokrasi seperti ini. Karena ini ada yang terganggu, gitu ya. Tapi menurut saya adalah demokrasi kita ini sudah nggak bisa mundur lagi. Kita sudah berada pada posisi yang seperti ini. Tapi yang kita pikirkan adalah ke depannya. Bagaimana tadi mendudukkan demokrasi itu pada posisi yang pas. Pada posisi yang sesuai dengan karakter Indonesia, di mana ada tepos liro. Mohon maaf, mungkin Mas Riza nggak ngerti tepos liro itu apa itu. Ngerti, itu bahasa Jawa. Bagaimana harus respek kepada orang tua, kepada siapapun yang tua lah ya gitu. Berikutnya kita tidak boleh semena-mena. Ah ini demokrasi, suka-suka gua, nggak bisa dong. Karena orang lain juga punya hak untuk itu. Tidak boleh lagi ya mengklaim bahwa kami adalah yang paling benar, lu salah, nggak bisa dong kan seperti itu. Kita sekali lagi kita dalam demokrasi adalah egaliter. Semua warga negara memiliki hak yang sama. Kita duduk pada posisi yang sama. Gitu. Kalau beda dengan zaman saya dulu, sekarang saya sudah sadar itu kan nggak seperti itu lagi kan begitu kira-kira. Untuk itulah saya waktu jadi Panglima saya juga menanamkan kepada prajurit-prajurit saya, kepada jenderal-jenderal saya, untuk pandai mendengar. Ya, itulah waktu saya jadi Panglima, memiliki program yang namanya TNI Mendengar. Saya ingin bahwa perwira-perwira saya itu pandai mendengar, tidak hanya pandai marah. Tidak mudah pandai mendengar itu ya. Tapi kita juga harus mendengar banyak kepada orang lain. Karena kalau tidak, kita hanya berpikir tentang diri kita. Tidak banyak mempertimbangkan bagaimana apa yang telah dipikirkan oleh orang lain. Itu kira-kira pandangan saya tentang demokrasi ya. Saya melihat kondisi real di lapangannya, saya juga mengalami, tapi saya juga ingin mendudukkan bagaimana demokrasi Indonesia ke depan pada posisi yang pas bagi bangsa Indonesia.
Ya, Pak Muldoko, ya kita masih punya waktu beberapa menit lagi. Saya ingin bertanya tentang satu soal yang tadi sudah disinggung sebetulnya, soal pandemi yang kita hadapi. Ya harus kita akui bahwa perjalanan pembangunan kita yang telah kita mulai sejak Orde Baru sampai dengan sekarang itu betul-betul mendapat ujian yang sangat serius ya, karena pandemi ini menjadi semacam disruptor juga dia, mendisrupsi ya. Apa yang sudah kita planning dan tiba-tiba semuanya harus di-adjust, harus disesuaikan gitu. Dan kita nggak tahu dia akan berjalan sampai kapan. Mudah-mudahan vaksin ditemukan dan tidak ada strain baru sehingga rakyat bisa semua sehat gitu kan, dan ekonomi bisa kembali bangkit gitu. Cuma masalahnya dengan plan yang sudah kita buat untuk menuju 2030, apa saja Pak yang harus kita perhatikan, karena pandemi ini telah membuat fokus kita bergeser gitu. Paling tidak kita menyadari bahwa pembangunan kesehatan itu benar-benar penting untuk ketahanan sebuah bangsa. Bahkan kita lihat bangsa-bangsa yang negara-negara yang kuat, yang kita tahu secara ekonomi baik pun diterpa pandemi, semuanya kewalahan gitu. Apalagi kita yang sedang naik mendaki ini, Pak. Ya kan? Sedang dalam pendakian Indonesia ini. Ya, sebentar lagi mudah-mudahan kita sejajar dengan mereka yang ada di puncak. Ya, mungkin bisa dijelaskan, Pak. Apa contingency plan yang dibuat oleh pemerintah menghadapi pandemi ini dan rangka program yang jangka panjang tadi itu, Pak? Jadi apa aja yang didisrupsi dan apa yang harus kita selamatkan agar kita tetap berada dalam roadmap menuju 2045 itu, Pak?
Ya, saya pikir untuk keberlangsungan pembangunan ke depan ya, yang pertama ada lima hal yang menjadi arahan Pak Jokowi ya ke depan, yaitu pembangunan sumber daya manusia. Ya. Tadi sudah saya urai ke depan bagaimana pembangunan sumber daya manusia itu menjadi hal yang sangat diperhatikan, bagaimana penanganan di bidang kesehatan, bagaimana penanganan di bidang pendidikan, bagaimana penanganan di bidang kesejahteraan, ya itu semuanya ditangani sehingga indeks apa pembangunan manusia kita menjadi meningkat dengan baik. Itu pembangunan sumber daya manusia. Berikutnya pembangunan infrastruktur ya, pembangunan infrastruktur tetap dilanjutkan. Kalau kita sekarang membangun highway-highway, maka pembangunan infrastruktur ke depan lebih dititik beratkan pada pengembangan wilayah pengembangan baru, wilayah kawasan-kawasan baru, kawasan apa itu pariwisata dikembangkan, kawasan industri baru dikembangkan, kawasan perumahan baru dikembangkan, sehingga ya sehingga pembangunan infrastruktur yang saat ini terjadi betul-betul memiliki added value untuk pembangunan yang semakin masif ke depan. Itu pembangunan infrastruktur. Tapi pembangunan infrastruktur juga bukan hanya pembangunan infrastruktur apa itu jalan, tapi juga darat ya, bukan hanya darat, tapi juga ada pembangunan pelabuhan, sehingga pelabuhan udara, sekarang ini sudah terbangun 15 pelabuhan udara. Berikutnya pembangunan pelabuhan laut juga harus diperhatikan, karena kita, konsep kita adalah bagaimana laut itu menyatukan, bukan laut itu memisahkan. Laut menjadi penyatu bagi bangsa Indonesia. Untuk itulah membangun tol laut yang dijalankan oleh pemerintah betul-betul dirasakan, ya, karena pemerintah telah memberikan subsidi terhadap kapal-kapal ke arah Indonesia Timur ini sungguh sangat dirasakan, ya, sungguh sangat dirasakan saat ini. Berikutnya juga pembangunan infrastruktur di pertanian, ya, karena kita sebagai negara agraris, pembangunan infrastruktur sangat cukup masif di pertanian, sehingga apa? Petani kita bisa merasakan bagaimana jalan-jalan produksi, bagaimana penyediaan air untuk kebutuhan tanam dari waktu ke waktu disediakan oleh pemerintah. Infrastruktur pendidikan juga demikian, infrastruktur kesehatan juga demikian telah dibenahi secara masif mulai dari puskesmas sampai dengan ke atas. Itu pembangunan infrastruktur. Berikutnya adalah regulasi, ya, penyederhanaan regulasi. Ini sebuah keharusan. Kenapa? Karena salah satu prasyarat investasi adalah itu. Kalau regulasinya nyebelin, bikin orang mumet, apa bikin orang sakit perut, maka saya yakinlah itu tidak bisa berjalan dengan baik investasi. Prasyarat investasi menurut saya adalah satu, regulasi, memberikan kepastian. Ya. Yang kedua, memberikan pelayanan. Untuk itu perlu reformasi birokrasi dengan sebaik-baiknya. Yang ketiga, memiliki stabilitas politik yang baik, stabilitas keamanan yang baik, dan stabilitas ekonomi yang baik. Maka saya yakin kalau itu terjaga, pasti, ya pasti kita sangat bagus ke depan. Yang kelima ini dari lima hal tadi adalah bagaimana transformasi ekonomi. Kita harus menuju transformasi ekonomi. Tidak boleh lagi kita abai itu, tidak boleh lagi kita ketinggalan itu, maka itu sebuah keharusan yang kita tangkap. Kalau enggak, kita terlambat. Itu kira-kira.
Ya, menarik sekali, Pak. Transformasi ekonomi. Saya kira itu yang sedang kita perjuangkan dan kita kerjakan saat ini bersama-sama sebagai bangsa. Baik, Pak Muldoko, waktunya sudah mengharuskan kita berhenti. Terima kasih sekali atas waktu yang diberikan oleh Pak Muldoko untuk kami di Jakarta Post dalam acara interview sore hari ini, berbincang-bincang dan rangka merayakan Republik Indonesia yang berusia 75 tahun. Sekali lagi, terima kasih banyak.
So that was our talk show with Presidential Chief of Staff, Pak Muldoko. Pak Muldoko highlighted some points in the interview. He mentioned some challenges for Indonesia's human capital development. Among them is the COVID-19 pandemic that had forced the government to focus more on health issues amid the government's effort to anticipate a demographic bonus. However, he said Indonesians had been more socially aware following the pandemic, which the government could use as social capital for human capital development. Now we will have a quick break. We will play some videos from the Post Multimedia team, and we will back shortly and start the discussion.
Jadi perjuangan mereka tuh sangat ini ya, mereka sangat semangat sekali untuk pergi ke sekolah. Walaupun kondisinya banjir, mereka tetap ingin sampai di sekolah walaupun dalam keadaan basah kuyup. Dan aksesnya itu memang cuma satu-satunya lewat jalur pantai, nggak ada akses lain. Satu, pada musim seperti ini, pada musim penghujan seperti ini, yaitu takut ketika pada saat mereka menyeberang dan terus ke bawah banjir. Memang sesuai yang sudah diinstruksikan bahwa kami melakukan proses pembelajaran dari rumah, tapi mengingat di desa kami itu untuk jaringan internet sangat susah, jadi tidak berjalan efektif ya. Orang tua mereka juga tidak mampu untuk membeli mereka smartphone untuk anak-anaknya, itu proses belajar dari rumah itu orang tuanya nggak bisa beli. Makanya kita inisiatif sendiri, para guru-guru itu kita door to door ngajarnya, jadi kita dari rumah ke rumah.
Bagaimana?
Kalau pergi ke sekolah jam 6 sampai di sekolah jam 7 karena 1 jam perjalanan. Biasanya jalan kaki kalau pergi sekolah.
Takut tidak kalau lewat sungai-sungai?
Takut ibu, apalagi kalau banjir.
Bagaimana sekolah di masa pandemi?
Ingin aku bareng sih, ada HP.
Oke Nanda, apa yang bikin semangat ke sekolah tiap hari?
Karena ada teman di sekolah banyak.
Karena di sekolah.
Harapan kami untuk buat pemerintah yaitu mungkin pendidikan di Indonesia bagian timur itu lebih diperhatikan lagi untuk akses jalan dan juga jembatan, itu yang paling penting, karena memang ketika ada jalan kemudian ada tidak ada jembatan juga sama saja bohong, karena di sini banyak sekali sungai-sungai atau kali-kali besar di sini, dan ketika banjir itu sangat fatal.
Ini dia anu neki lho dia. Teks iki. Ya to dulu mase to. Aku butuh teks iki lho, aku ora iso ngomong bahasa Inggris lancar nek orang aku kuwi.
Yeah, welcome back. That was one of many videos produced by The Post. If you like them, do check out our other multimedia reports on our website, www.thejakartapost.com, YouTube channel, Twitter, and Instagram. Now we are moving along to the discussion. Already here with us, four distinguished speakers. Here we have Ibu Deni Puspa Purbasari, Pre-Appointment Card Management Executive Director. Good afternoon, Ibu. And we have also Bapak Profesor Dr. Tajuddin Nur Effendi, a scholar from Gajah Mada University. Good afternoon, Pak. We also have Pak Anton J. Supit, Vice Chairman of Indonesian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, or KADIN. We also have Ibu Connie Ang, CEO of Danone Specialized Nutrition Indonesia. My senior editor at The Post, Pak Endi Bayuni, or Pak Endi, will moderate this panel. I would like to remind everyone that we will have a question and answer session after all speakers finish with their presentation. If you have any question as we go through with the presentations, please use the Q&A feature or chat room on the Zoom app, and please don't hesitate to ask in Bahasa Indonesia because we will translate your question for you. Without further ado, I would like to hand over the platform to Pak Endi. Please, Pak Endi.
Oke, thank you Gina. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Selamat siang, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you to all of you for joining this webinar. I promise you this will be worth your time. We have four very distinguished speakers to take us through this discussion about the human development capital and the Indonesian Vision 2045. You know, with this COVID-19 pandemic, we should never lose sight of the big picture and of the long-term vision of Indonesia in 2045, when we as a nation mark the centenary of our existence. That interview that we have just seen with Pak Mudoko is very revealing. He is a very close confidant of President Jokowi. He shared with us the vision 2045 and how we are going to get there. And so if you missed that video, I suggest that you watch the recording on the JP website later on. The video of the school kids in Maluku, again, that's very interesting. And when we talk about human development capital, we are actually talking about these kids. They are the future of Indonesia. So on that note, I think let's move on with the seminar. Let me just set the stage first. The Vision 2045, in that vision, Indonesia is going to be in the top five largest economies in the world. We are already on our way there. Now Indonesia, according to most analysis, we are in the number 16 largest in the world. And the trajectory is that we are continuing to move up the ranking. And this has been confirmed by studies from Standard Chartered and PricewaterhouseCoopers, which says that even before 2045, Indonesia will become in the top five economies in the world. However, we should not take this for granted, because to get there, we still need the right kind of people, the right kind of leaders and communities. And for that, I think we need to pay attention to the human capital development. We need to invest on people and make sure that we get there. Invest in the education, invest in the health. And as Pak Mudoko explained, and we still have many problems on these issues, education, skills, and health that we need to address. And this webinar will hopefully shed some light on some of these problems and of course the solutions. The four speakers, each one represents different sectors. Ibu Deni represents for the government. Professor Tajuddin, he represents the academia. And then we have Anton Supit, represents the business sector. And last but not least, Ibu Koni represents from, I guess, as a nutritionist. She represents from the health sector. I will ask each one of them to speak discuss with me, because I will have some questions for about 10 minutes or up to 15 minutes each. And then after that, we will open this discussion to the audience. We have the chat room and the Q&A room. Use them to convey your questions or your comments. And then after we go through all the four speakers, we will pick some of the best questions and then throw them to the floor for the panelists to answer. So let me first turn to Ibu Deni Puspa Purbasari. She is the executive director of the pre-employment card management. Ibu Deni, you have been part of the presidential chief of staff office, which conducted evaluation and monitoring on public policies. What would you consider as the biggest challenges on human capital development in Indonesia and what are the opportunities that need to be explored in the future to reach the 2045 vision. I understand you have slides as well, so welcome to use them as well.
Thank you, Pak Andy. Hello, everybody. So first of all, I would like to make a disclaimer. I'm no longer doing a service as an economic deputy at the Executive Office of the President. I resigned since the 1st of April this year to make sure that the pre-employment card is actually, you know, I can have like 100% of my attention there. So I'm not really in charge for the economic monitoring and evaluation anymore. So, but in related to the vision of 2045, I would like to share with you some of presentation that I make here. Okay, I wish everybody can see my presentation. Is it all right?
Yes.
Yes. All right. So first of all, Pak Muldoko in the previous session mentioned about the vision of 2045. I am an economist, so my focus may be on the goal for Indonesia to be a developed nation, developed country. With the income per capita, according to World Bank, is about $12,000. At this moment, 2020, Indonesian income per capita is only about $4,000. How to get from that level towards $12,000? As an economist, we learn about growth theory. So we know that we need to have a persistent economic growth, the growth in income per capita from now until 2045. To support economic growth that is persistent in such long period, we need to make sure there is a persistent productivity growth. So productivity growth as the main catalyst toward that goal. And we also learn and believe that productivity growth, whether that's human capital growth, or whether that's technology growth, or total factor productivity growth, all of those kind of growth coming from human, coming from population. So investing in education, investing in health, investing in trainings, and everything that focus on human capabilities become an important point towards 2045 goal. So if you're looking at 2020 or 2045, at any point of time, there will be different generations live together. So in economics, we talk about overlapping generation. In 2020, we have some infants. Even we have a woman who are basically conveying, you know, babies in their womb. So, and we also have teenagers. We have adults who are in the working age. And we also have adults entering, you know, elderly period. 25 years later, those people, those generations, from infants becoming working age, teenagers becoming working age becoming elderly, and elderly, maybe some of them passed away. So when we're talking about pre-employment card, we are actually focusing on the working age now. So here in the infant period, during the infant period, I believe the investment mostly on health. The issue of stunting, for example, and also mortality rate, basically in here, in this level. And then and during a teenager period, so the focus on education, that's what I believe. And then for working age, the results of education and health investment become very crucial. And pre-employment card is actually providing like a complement program or vocational training for the working age here. There are other programs supporting the same goal. So pre-employment card is not the only program that provides trainings for the working population. So that's basically the idea of how pre-employment card program supports the goal of 2045 starting from 2020. This program hopefully will be continued until 2024. And if the public believes in this program, feel the benefit of this program, we hope this program will be continued beyond 2045. So in order to support that goal, we see some challenges and opportunities. The challenge that we face, number one, is Indonesia ranked 72nd out of 78 countries in terms of literacy and mathematics is a score. So we know a lot of homework here, basically in Ministry of Education. A lot of work has been done there. The second challenge is 1 out of 5 Indonesian youth are not in education, employment, or trainings. This is based on the research of the World Bank. So when we are talking about bonus demography or demographic bonus, it is very important how we have some innovative program to make sure that our youth can provide or can reveal their true potentials. Because again, we cannot basically turn back and rewind to education and health, but how actually we can complement like a jumpstart program to make sure that their potentials are revealed such that they can tap the opportunities provided by the economy. And then what are the opportunities in our economy? Well, for those challenges, we also have some opportunities. Number one, again, we're talking about a young population that Indonesia has. If I'm not mistaken, now until 2030. So we have to make sure we have, again, innovative effort to make sure that they are productive as soon as possible. Otherwise, they are lost generation. Otherwise, we lose a lot. The country lose a lot. The nation lose a lot. The numbers, and then the second opportunities that we have is basically about the mobile penetration. We have 152 million internet users in Indonesia, majority, of course, the young. And according to the research by Google, Temasek, and Bain in 2019, we have internet economic growth of 49% per year in the last 5 years. So there is opportunity provided by the usage of internet in the economy. So how we are going to basically tap this opportunity to leverage education, health, and also trainings that has been provided in the country or will be provided in the country such that the young generation becoming more and more productive. So talking about the pre-employment card, I would like to share with you what is pre-employment card. So do not be mistaken with the title, but it is more about training voucher. In the West or in the developed countries, we know about education voucher or school voucher, where the government basically gives certain amount of money or voucher towards parents to send their kids to school, wherever school they want to choose, they want to go. So it is the same thing with pre-employment card. So the government this time provided 1 million rupiah each person in order to take whatever trainings that they want to have such that they are more productive. So the kind of trainings that we provide so far, unfortunately, because of the pandemic, is provided online only, because we do not want to risk the health of our populations, especially in the big cities. And we know that, you know, offline trainings typically only available in big cities. So we predict there will be a lot of mobility or movement from people from kabupatens or districts to the cities. So we are worried about their, you know, health. So at this moment, we only provide online trainings. But this is actually a blessing in disguise, because at this moment, we have 2,000 types of trainings available in the ecosystem that they can choose, the participants can choose from e-marketplace, digital platforms that are available and becoming our partners. So this is the type of collaboration between to serve the population. So we during the design of the policy, we understand that providing voucher itself is not sufficient, because we are sure that there is difficulty to select, to compare, to know the syllabus, the price, and also the content, the institution's information of the training providers. So that's why we are inspired by the innovation in the private sector, such as, let me name some of them, Traveloka, for example, GoFood, Bukalapak, or Shopee, or Tokopedia, that basically can, you know, facilitate the transaction between the buyers and also the providers or the sellers. So we just try to mimic that kind of model into pre-employment card. So everybody actually can see whatever trainings provided in the ecosystem, and they can compare the price, the services, the scope of the trainings, etc., etc. And they also can compare the trainings provided in the ecosystem with whatever that is available freely in the YouTube or other resources. Of course, we believe in the choice of the people. People are wise. People are the ones who understand about their, what they need, their preference. And I would like to share with you later our achievement, because this program is very young. So we also need to hear your inputs about this program. I stop here, Pak.
Thank you, Bu Deni. If I may ask one question again. When you launched the pre-employment card in April, that was also the peak of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I remember President Jokowi said that the pre-employment card is also going to be available for people who lost their jobs. Now, is that still the case today? And can you just give us a kind of the figures of people who have signed up and taken up this pre-employment card?
Yes, Pak. So let me tell you about the design before and after, before and during the pandemic. So before the pandemic, so again, pre-employment card was designed since May 2019. And then the presidential decree and also the minister, coordinating minister of economic affairs decree were launched in February and March this year. So it takes 7 months to prepare for the regulations. And then when we are going, when we were about, you know, releasing the program, pandemic occurred. So according to Mr. President, so President Jokowi said that, please adjust the program from competence oriented to competence and social assistance oriented. So we are in this one, the one in the middle. So what happened here is that the amount of the training voucher itself is reduced, because online is actually cheaper than the offline, because there is no operating cost whatsoever. And then what happened here is that we shift some amount toward the post-training incentive that basically support the spending of the household. And then after the pandemic later, we will go back to the pre-pandemic program. So this is the result part of the evaluation, quick evaluation that we have, because basically we are mandated to launch the survey to the recipients. Again, this is recipients, not the public. And then the first response coming from the 361,000 participants. And this is the results. So pre-employment card is actually well targeted. And we have the statistic here, 90% of the participants unemployed, 85% young, and then 59% affected by COVID-19, whether they are the workers or they are the small business owners. And then 93% high school graduates and above. So they are quite educated. And then 79% of them actually informal workers and small small business owners, 63% male. And the number of employees of the small business owners, only one. So we are believe that they are actually, you know, small and also workers who are basically losing their job because of the pandemic. And then we also look at the right here, 56% of them experience loss in their income due to COVID. And then the median of monthly income of the recipients is 1.2 million, much lower than the regional minimum wage. And then 37 of the proportion of cash transfer, the incentive, is actually, you know, the proportion is 37% of their income. So this is quite significant to support their life. And then 54% of the income, their income is only 54% of the regional minimum wage. And then 89% of them have concern about their food security. And then this is about the trainings. The result of the survey say that pre-employment card trainings are relevant for skilling, reskilling, and upskilling. Here, when we are talking about entrepreneurship, that basically becoming the alternatives of the livelihoods of the workers who are losing their job. 93% say that actually the trainings provided in pre-employment card programs give them new ways or strategies for work as an entrepreneur. And then next, the last one, we are talking about the income support of 600,000 rupiah per month. So at this moment, we also have collaboration with three e-money companies, e-money providers, GoPay, Link Aja, and also OVO. So we can monitor what actually they spend. And on top of that, during the survey, we also ask the usage of the incentive. So 97% of them say that they use the money to buy food, 75% to pay electricity bills, and then 69% for fuel, and then 68% for internet, and the last one for transportation. So we can say that the incentive is actually necessary and for to support their basically life during the pandemic. So that's what happened in the pre-employment card part.
Yeah, just one last question. You mentioned earlier that you envision that this pre-employment card, or you hope this pre-employment card program will continue all the way until 2045. Can you talk about, okay, if that is the vision, how is this program going to develop in the coming years? Because this is still just a beginning, but obviously you have big plans, but how are you going to develop this? How is it going to evolve in the next 25 years?
Thank you, Pak. So I would like to say something like this. So I would like to talk about number two. But my experience of steering the pre-employment card, basically there are three takeaways. Number one is about policy. Number two, the relevance of the content and the policy itself within the society context. And then the third one on communication. So answering your question, Pak, I think I can tell that there is some success of implementation of the pre-employment card, even though this program is quite young, but there is some success. At least we can see it from the survey. The survey is honest, designed by six top economists in Indonesia. So talking about the future of this program, Pak, I believe that this program can be continued in the future if we keep remembering that pre-employment card is not just a program. Because when we hear program, what we think is just like government activity to spend money, to spend state budget. But when we design pre-employment card, in our mind, is actually thinking about pre-employment card as a product. When we are talking about a product, we have to make sure we listen to the consumer voice. We listen to their feedback. And when we use e-marketplace like GoFood or like a Traveloka or Tokopedia and others, we know that consumers actually can put some ratings or assign some ratings or evaluation on the trainings that they actually already taken before. So here, it is like a totally different approach from the previous programs or many programs that the government have, that pre-employment card is actually trying to listen to the voice of the consumers and then take into account their concern in order to make the program or the product relevant over time. So this is a different, I think different perspective, such that if we do that, I believe that continuous improvement of the product itself will take place. So we try to improve trainings that we provide by informing to the market players, this is the response or this is the opinion of your consumers. So, and market actually can provide such mechanism because when the consumers are unhappy, they will assign 1 star out of 5 stars. And then what happens is that the future consumers will look at those review and then they will not buy the trainings. So I would like to inform you at this moment, again, there are 2000 trainings available, but only 1500 sold. So the rest not necessarily bad, but the rest should work harder in order to make sure that product can be seen and can be evaluated by the consumer as a good product such that they will buy. And then their testimony will be valuable for them in order to attract more and more buyers to buy the product. So it is very important, but I believe in the market mechanism to basically reward and punish the market participants such that on the training providers in order to make sure that the relevance of the programs will be continued along the way.
Thank you, Bu Reni. Please stay with us. We're going to move to the next panelist. Just one short comment. I know some of my neighbors who actually have joined the pre-employment card and they're happy that they're getting cash as well as training. In a way, it's a kind of unemployment benefit plus the training. Maybe this is something that can be developed later into an unemployment benefit program plus the training for those who are actually out of jobs. Just my thinking. Now I'd like to turn to Professor Tajuddin, who is in Yogyakarta, apa ya? Professor Tajuddin also has I think slides for presentations. But let me just ask the question first, staying on the question on the issue of unemployment. As we are, there is this problem of skills gap between those who are graduating from colleges or even from vocational schools. And when they turn to the labor market, they found that they don't have the skills. This is a big problem. The fact that the unemployment graduates for vocational high school is the highest at 8.49%. This is a survey on February 2020. So what's actually gone wrong? And what do you think the current policies, are they enough to transform, to change this employment condition? Keep in mind, we are now already in this demographic dividend era. If you don't capitalize on this and that many people are actually unemployed, I think we will lose that opportunity and that demographic bonus become demographic liability. So, Professor, Well, what do you think is the problem and how we can resolve this? Your microphone, but can you unmute? Can you unmute yourself? The microphone is off. You have to unmute.
Yeah, okay. It. It's okay?
Thank you. Yes, good. Okay. Good.
Good morning. Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. There are some factors influencing the gap skill between university, vocational graduate, and private sector. Teacher quality, equipment for student practicing, and maybe infrastructure, and so on. There are many things. But the important, very important, I think, is curriculum. It seemed to me curriculum in Indonesian university and vocational school is not matched with the skilled private or labor market needed. The problem is the university or vocation school probably tool or equipment, technology used for practical student training not in line to technology used in private sector or labor market. Nowadays, digital technology, 4.0, may be already used in the industry sector. However, many university or vocational school instrument or equipment for student practical still using manual equipment. Even in university, still, you know, using manual equipment. Because of that, I think to solve the problem, maybe we have to prepare some transition from university or from school to labor market. The vocational graduates and they need additional skills. So I think they have to need something training center to get additional skill. And it seemed to me that a policy to develop vocational training is needed as one of strategy to solve the problem, to close skill gap between university and vocational grade between labor market or private sector. Another problem I think is now manufacturing or already something declined, you know. Maybe the working people in manufacturing about 18%. And service sector increase subtly. Then maybe the graduate from technical backgrounds, they find difficulty to get job in the service sector compared to general school. Maybe general school is more flexible to enter the labor market because they can, you know, they do whatever, you know, labor market need. So I think this kind of a problem will be serious because now the manufacturing employment still, you know, very low. We need maybe to wait till there are many investors come to Indonesia. The policy that you ask, how to solve the problem. In order to close skill gap need policy, strengthen the education quality insurance system by acting on quality assessment is very important. Then provide more information to students on labor market opportunities. Sometimes graduate from school, they don't have information what occupation available in labor market. make tertiary and vocational education more responsive to the market needs. Create more training institution. Pak Anton will be, what call it, explain about the training institution, the very important training institution, because they can deliver relevant training and specific skill in higher value added and strategic sector. There are many, you know, suggestions. We have to raise the level skill of general population through basic education. I think if we do it, I think we will need time. Even if the educational system could be perfected instantly, the first graduate would be only joined to labor market force about 20 years time. So we have to wait for a long time. I think it's not good policy. Now, considering the current skill constraint, needed the strategy are thus improving the relevance of feeder into the labor market, technical vocational education and tertiary education, and upgrading the skill of the existing labor force. We may be, that Bu Denis put, it could be skilling, reskilling, or upskilling. That I think we need vocational training. Nice to say, but not easy to implement. Since COVID-19 pandemic spread out everything, including education, goes uncertainty. There is potential for lost generation due to COVID pandemic. You know, or maybe wrong. I think not. This is not for this question. Later, later, maybe question number 4 or number 3. It is estimated that 65 schools are not able to conduct distance learning due to uneven internet access, poor household students not able to pay data, or maybe low signal. The lost generation could have impact on the future of human resources quality. It's not easy to solve the problem, because we already talking about this, our discussion about this since 1990. I already informed maybe 30 years. I'm really, you know, Pak Anton maybe knows that I will always, that I already discuss about this, but still, you know, the problem still, you know, not solved, because there are many constraints, not only money, but the human resource development also that we need to develop. I think this is my answer to your question. Okay?
Yes, thank you, Professor. Sounds very gloomy. I think you're stating the problem very clearly, and this is a problem that has been going on since the 1990s. And problem is education. You mentioned teachers, infrastructures, equipment, curriculum. But President Jokowi, in his first term, when he traveled to Germany, he learned the value of vocational schools. And I think he came back here and ordered the Minister of Education and the business sector to pay attention to build more vocational training schools.
Yeah.
Because this is the way forward for Indonesia to answer the question of the skills gap. But it hasn't happened, right? So what is happening here? Because here we also talk about the collaboration from the private sector. I will ask the same question to Pak Anton later. What can the business do to help with this improving of the skills of our workforce?
I think they have something like a very difficult to enter labor market because they are very limited skill. They need to training. But the problem is training in Indonesia are really, really not as we hope, but it's very, very limited, you know, because we need a lot of funds to develop or to establish nice, training center. Now, we can learn from German. German is good example that successfully seen German implemented dual system education and training. They call it dual FET, dual vocation education training. Maybe Pak Anton will tell us because they went to German several times. Yeah, dual FET have been provide competent workers for German companies. There is a collaboration between education, university, or maybe high school person. Then they put the system, put the young people through 3 years trainingship composed 50-50, or maybe 70-30, or maybe 60-40 classroom instruction in job training in participating companies under supervision of skilled mentors. They really very good in terms of training system. Young people emerge from training how to get job than in real work environment. I think this is very important. If we, you know, now there are, you know, there are many training center in Indonesia, but maybe they're not really using like what they did in German. So I think we have a good example how to develop training education or maybe training center. They have in the regional province, there are many training center. I don't know how many good training center in Indonesia. Maybe there are, but not really solve the problem because, you know, young labor enter the labor market is very, you know, every year about 2.15 million people, new entrants to labor market. All of them need training. So we have to establish maybe there are many training center that really can help all the unemployment persons. Okay?
Yes, I will ask the same question later to Pak Anton. But just one last question to Professor. You know, the character of the Indonesian workforce is that the majority of them are working in the informal sector rather than formal.
Yeah.
And this has been the case. But as we, you know,
no,
as
but become a developed country,
it's 50%.
Yeah, 55%.
55.
Yeah, 55%.
Now, as Indonesia becomes a developed country in 2045, are we going to change this structure, and are we going to shift more people from the informal sector to the formal sector, and how do we go about it?
Yeah, I think it's impossible. We still need informal sector, and will continue to be as employment and earning income to livelihood of less educated labor, because we still have, you know, people less educated. It's not easy, you know, to give them job. The informal sector, I think, it still exists. If there is no still informal sector, they will die. Yeah, some people said we need a strategy for improving productivity and incomes informal sector through skill development. It's not easy. You know, yeah, like I said, nice to say, but it's not easy to implement. Because there are many constraints. This, for example, this one. constraint. This World Bank study in Africa, they try to develop skill development for the informal sector. After now they maybe research there about several years, they find that it's not easy. You know, skill needs, low level education, multi-skilling needs, technical and low capacity to identify training needs because they are heterogeneous. There are many kind of occupation. Yeah, for example, in Indonesia, from tukang beca driver till street vendors and everything, how we organize the training center such kind of heterogeneous occupation. Then maybe limited supply catering to informal sector, high productive opportunity cost. Maybe 10 years ago, there is someone from Sweden. He want to develop earning of the informal sector in Indonesia, in Yogyakarta, especially beca driver. He gave them what call it something like a recorder. You know, in order the passengers happy with the beca driver, is it let solve the problem? I think no, because they depend on the passengers. Not passengers might be not really think about what call it. Maybe there are many people who want to develop informal sector, but there are many problem. Can you split this figure, please? Hello? Yeah. Just a moment. I have to go out to go. The constraint is, for example, if you want to develop skill development of informal sector, it's very, very difficult to find them because they unregistered activities or occupation. They spread out in, in every place. So Budeni said they can many informal sector can get pre-employment card. I think it's very good, but it seemed to me not easy to find informal sector workers because they involve in circular migration. They come to urban in several times, they back to rural, back to the village, and change the occupation from one occupation to another occupation. Yeah, in Central Java, we know they call boboro. Boboro, it means someone move from one place to get jobs. Because it's not easy for them. Some would call it get a permanent job. They may be today become selling bakso, maybe a week later they will maybe selling ice cream or whatever. Then what kind of skill we have to give for them? You give management? I think it's now. Yeah, this is very difficult. There are many concerns. If you want to develop informal skill, because they really have spread out of the occupation. So yeah, in the future, we still need informal sector. Then, as you know, during the crisis, informal sector becomes safety social net. They help our economy. Don't kill them, otherwise you will suffer. this is my opinion. Okay.
Thank you, Professor. I agree. I think the informal sector was a cushion for the poor people this happened in the 1998 economic crisis.
Yeah.
And it's happening again. So I think the informal sector will always like the backbone of the economy because the big corporations may fall, but I think the small and medium companies and they employ people in the informal sector, they many of them continue to thrive. But I just think that as Indonesia becomes a developed country in 2045, I think we should also be thinking about reducing the number of people in the informal sector and move, shift them into the formal sector, where there is actually labor protection, where they can actually form unions to protect them. And there also are the guarantees that are being given if you work in the formal sector.
No, you can see that becak driver now reduce because the young guys, they not want to become a becak driver. The becak breaker, then all the people. Yeah. If you go to Jogja, you can see, you know, there is no young guys become a becak driver. It's mean maybe 10 years ahead, becak driver will demolish from in the street in Yogyakarta.
Thank you, Professor. Please stay with us because there will be Q&A afterwards. I'd like to turn to Pak Anton. Are you in Jakarta, Pak Anton?
In Jakarta, Pak Andy.
In Jakarta, okay.
Yeah.
Just to pick up on the questions or issues that Professor Tajuddin raised about collaboration between government and the private sector in improving the skill gap of the workforce. Yeah. What has the private business sector done in helping to improve the skill of the Indonesian workforce? And what programs do you have in place? And what programs you should have in helping to remedy this situation?
Thank you, Andy. If you don't mind, maybe I give some information before I answer your question.
Please do.
I think I remember 8 or 10 years ago, McKinsey have a presentation in Ritz-Carlton in front of our president, SBY, and all of us, flat rate, I don't know if it's correct or not, terpesona, that the presentation, he explained that in the year 2045, our country will become number 6, the biggest GDP in the world. Mm-hmm. But all we forgot, but at the end of presentation, and not written, because everything he in written, but only the last sentence he not mentioned, that this condition can happen if, always we forgot about if, Pak Andy. We very nice to hear we will become big. And then we sometimes already imagine that we are the big country. We already become 6, now 16 or maybe 10, something like that. But if we talk about Indonesia gold, it means we must talk about the competitiveness. Now, the problem, my question is, are we have the international competitiveness? And then if we want to elaborate about international competitiveness, I just copy from the World Economic Forum. There are 12 pillars of international pillar of competitiveness. And there are 2 or 3, the number is about the human, because today we talk about human capital. Health and primary education is one of the conditions, and another is higher education and training, and also about labor market efficiency. I think if we talk, for example, health, I forgot now the situation, but when I talked with one professor from IPB, according him, at that time, 49% pregnant woman malnutrition. And you can imagine almost 50%. I don't know now, maybe Budeni can help to give answer how many now. And then you can imagine without good health, how we can have a good, human capital, because human capital is, I think it is more complex than human resource. Because if talk human capital, we talk about the system, and then of course we talk about everything, not only the people. That's why it is not easy. That's why I usually sometimes criticize, because we only talk about piece by piece. Nobody talk about the comprehensive thing that it's mean, yeah, international competitiveness. How we improve number one until number 12. I mean, we talk about that, but I mean in the field, we kissing is not happen, especially now because regional autonomy, because only us in the capital, I mean in Jakarta, talk about this matter. But once Pak Endi go to Kabupaten, and nobody talk about international competitiveness, and then you know the story. We cannot finish one night if we talk about that. That's why about Pak Endi question. Of course, the vocational become popular since our president Pak Jokowi met Chancellor Angela Merkel the first term. And then at that time we talk more serious about vocational. And I think especially now the current situation after COVID, this is not after, we still struggling with COVID. We must know that there are highly education people, university degree, academic, and another. But also there is broad-based unskilled worker. Unskilled worker, and then considering the situation right now, industry now start to recovery, and in time like this, skill human capital who very adaptive and have risk competitiveness and what the industry need. Because learn from the epidemic pandemic. I mean, the technology is more influence in our economy. We cannot like before. And then, if you ask about the, I talk on behalf the private sector. Friendly speaking, not many people consider about how important the human, I mean, capital. They always consider this is costly. I mean, to educate the people, and then that's why I think there are must a big effort. I mean, if we compare with Germany already start a couple hundred years ago, and in Germany, what we call is a bottom up. I mean, government only involved since 1970. And then the government issued what they call vocational law. But before that, awareness from the business society. That's why they set up the system, vocational. And if we talk about vocational, not only Germany, even United States now, even Trump now issued the president degree to apprentice. I visit Japan and another country, also they doing the vocational, but if we talk vocational, it's not strong like in Germany, because Germany is already including in the system. And if we talk about TVET in Germany, TVET's already become the economic strategic. It's not only for the human, improve the human capability, but also strategic economic. That's why even there are many crises, always Germany can succeed. Yeah. If now we talk about Indonesia, in Indonesia is difficult because our Indonesia business society, frankly speaking, that's why corruption and nepotism is very bad for the competitiveness, because we have no chance to improve the capability, the competitiveness, because many people, until now, I think, still there are the facility and license. You say that is very important. And then I don't like talk one by one in this forum, but I mean, we have no chance to train the people. We can get a good manager, good operator, and this and that. I think now that we hope since the pandemic happened, and then this has become U-turn. We realize, but to compete in the globalization, we must have, the good people. And then if we talk about good people, we must talk about education. If I can copy what the JFK, Kennedy statement, that there is only one thing in the long run more expensive than education, yaitu no education. And then if we talk education, yeah, Pak Andy maybe know there's a the difference between Jakarta and another area. That's why I think our homework is still, I mean, a lot of homework. But now I think we expect the government realize this is the right time we improve. That's why I think what is needed to for future, I mean, because since turning into the industry 4.0, we need a skilled and trained worker. And solution is like Pak Tajuddin, Professor Tajuddin already mentioned, is dual education, I mean pendidikan ganda, sistem ganda yaitu TVET, technical and vocational education and training. And I think if we talk about vocational, there are two very important pillar is private sector, or usually in Indonesia we call DUDI, dunia usaha dan dunia industri, and also education including training. But Pak Andy know di Indonesia the very expensive thing is coordination. I mean we have four coordinating minister, but I mean still this is a luxurious if we talk about coordinating. Because several times in the public speech, public discussion, we always raise this issue. We must have a system. If we talk about vocational, not talk activity, but we talk about system. Because many activity, yeah, they call vocational, but sometimes it's not become a system, because if vocational system make guarantee that the whole Indonesia must have same quality, I mean, and if they get the certificate, competence certificate, they can work in everywhere, not only in Indonesia, but also in another country. The problem is, I mean, until now, yeah, we know always we argue in, if we talk vocational, we just talk maybe 3 or 4 years, in Germany already couple hundred, but I think we cannot wait 100 or 200 years. I mean, if we consider like that, and then we will, I mean, will become like almarhum Pak Daud Yusuf said, we become benalu in the globalization. The people who have no education, it's very difficult to live in the globalization now. Yeah, I think, Pak Andy, the biggest problem is how we can mobilization the private sector. And but I myself is not agree if we force them, but maybe we use incentive or disincentive. Government already give tax incentive, but it looks like until now not many people use, because that's why we suggest make better the scheme. Change, because until now only 18 company apply for this facility. And second, even already 18 company, we don't know this 18 company is do the right way or not. Because if Professor Tajuddin mentioned before, if we talk vocational, at least there are ratio 70 or 60, we will make decision by ourselves. 70 in Germany, 70, 30. And then really after when they start it SMK, I mean the high school, vocational high school, they already work in the factory. But you can imagine if 70% from 3 years they stay in the factory, after finished 3 years, they already no test direct work in the factory or easy to find job. If we compare with Malaysia start talk about vocational during Pak Mahathir as a prime minister in the first time in 1997, and then lead by Pak Mahathir. The vocational, and then needs 8 years and becomes right now in Malaysia. Now in Malaysia, when we visit Malaysia, government people talk to us that 80% from middle school SMP, they enter SMK vocational, and then the graduation from SMK vocational high school, almost 80 to 90, it's easy to find job. I think that's the benefit, not only for the worker, or I mean for the student, but also they are strengthened for the industry itself. That's why, as we see, always we complain before we send teacher to Malaysia, but now Malaysia is better, something like that, Pak Indy.
Thank you, Pak Anton. It seems like we are going in a circle because vocational schools actually produce graduates, but most of them cannot get employment because they are not the skills do not match with the requirements. And then on the business side, you say there is little awareness or reluctance to invest, take part in the vocational program, offering internship because of the lack of incentives or disincentives, as you say. So problem is actually a system. So we know the problem. We have the examples of other countries, Germany, you mentioned Japan, Malaysia, but we are not doing that. But I'd like to go back to your issue about the international competitiveness. One of the problems that with Indonesia is the low productivity of the workforce compared to even our neighbors. So here's a huge problem. What can the private sector do to help remedy this problem?
I think like this, if you talk in general, yeah, maybe we can talk our productivity is low, but some company, private company, like Toyota or like another big company, I think they have a good, good productivity. For example, I explain, Toyota, they have stock only what they call just in time. They only have 8 hours. You can imagine the factory in Karawang that with the stock with only 8 hours. If the productivity very low, and then they cannot produce car because one item's not coming, and then the production stop. But if we talk in generally, that's why the productivity is low, because I think there are many factor. Of course, we know that our labor law also not conducive. Not very good, because not easy hire, not easy fire. That's why we expect too much from the omnibus law. But that's why the answer is a vocational, because with the vocational, they enter the factory, they are not employee, and then they are not employers. With 3 years, I only talk about SMK. I not talk about the polytechnic and university, because in Indonesia there are 14,000 SMK and about maybe 5 million people. If we can do well for them, put in the right way for vocational, you can imagine we have every year maybe 1.5 million people with the high productivity, and then the soft skill also good because they have some training. And we also must start since beginning. If we start about vocational and apprentice in the factory, they must get payment. This is, there are several conditions, but until now, because we still set up the system, and then we have no national committee to make the policy. That's why still we try to find how the we make more effective. But if the answer, I think the TVET program, how we can succeed. If this is succeed, and then we can start with the good. The good concept. Finally, the businessmen will realize that because of TVET system, they will make more productivity people, and also the competitiveness. Yeah, like in Germany, because Germany put not only for the company itself, but they become a economic strategic to improve the competitiveness. But this is easy to say, but we now, if you ask what we done now, almost every week from Kadin, we talk in every area, how to explain the, about to set up the TVET committee in local area. Before me and Pak Tajudin together in the what we call KPVN, Komite Pelatihan Vokasi Nasional, in a labor minister. But yeah, after until now, we still waiting what's the new policy for the new minister. But this is still a long way to go. But the very important thing, the people who will make decision to for the policy must know first, I meet consider as a comprehensive what is TVET system. If not, we just understand based on our by artinya we just doing by ourselves, especially ego central. This is cannot happen. I mean, this is very important. The leadership who will lead this TVET system. Because I think if we talk TVET system, we talk like a new system, and we must change our mindset, like regional autonomy. We start with the new system. If we not change our mind, this is still same. I mean, the people cannot feel that autonomy make them more welfare and good for them. This is, I mean, not easy, but yeah, we hope if we still consistent, yeah, I mean, with this right concept, and then we can get a good support from government, I think we will do.
Thank you, Pak Anton. Now I'd like to turn to Ibu Connie. She's the CEO of Danone Specialized Nutrition Indonesia. Now, we heard that problem about stunting coming from malnutrition, and this is a big problem. And even the maternal death rates and child death rates, the problem is because they're not eating well or they're not eating enough. Can you tell us about the problem that you have found in your line of work as what Danone and what has Danone Nutrition has done in this area?
Thank you, Pak Andy. The stunting is definitely, as you heard from Pak Modoko as well, stunting is definitely an issue. Around 1 in 3 Indonesian children are under 5 are actually stunted. And the thing about stunting is that it has a significant impact for the health of the child, as well as the development of the child, both physically and mentally. And in fact, when this is not treated, especially in the first 3,000 days of the child's life, this has impact to non-communicable disease, the physical health, and also the general intelligence of the child. So therefore, nutrition is absolutely important. When you have children 1 in 3 that is stunted, what happens is basically it impacts the human capital development of Indonesia and stands in the way of, it's a barrier of Indonesia achieving 2045 vision. It is a complex issue. It is an issue that requires a multi-stakeholder approach. Requires the and Danone, we work a lot with different academia, with the healthcare industry, with parents, with association, because it requires a multi-stakeholder approach to really address stunting issue. If I may, Pak Andy, if I may share some data, if you look at that. Can you see my slide?
No.
Okay.
Yes,
now?
Yes, yeah. Got it.
So if you look at the stunting rate, 1 in 3 children under 5 are stunting. And the thing is that you have the very severe stunting, which is 17.7%, which we call wasting, which is really not enough food. But you also have, on the other hand, 8%, which is what you call obesity, which is actually too much of the wrong food. And very much, I think, in this pandemic, which we all know we are in the middle of this pandemic, it becomes even more serious. It becomes even more important because of economic impact of the pandemic. Many mothers or families will start to compromise on nutrition. Therefore, it's even very important that this conversation continues during this time more than ever. That we pay attention not only to the quantity of food, but also to the quality of food. And malnutrition, which is the result of stunting could come from both ends, basically not enough food or too much of the wrong food.
Yes, well, I think Mudoko mentioned a target from 24% down to 14% by 2024. Is that feasible? Is that something that, or is Dano also taking part in this government's efforts to bring down the stunting rate?
So definitely, as Dano, we are specialized nutrition here in Indonesia. And as Dano total with Aqua and specialized nutrition, we employ 15,000 people. We do a lot in the field of nutrition. This is our mission is to bring health through food to as many people as possible. And we do that in Indonesia. First of all, I think our stunting for because we are specialized nutrition for children who are already stunted, we've done a study with which we call the Pandagalang study, where we look at nutrition intervention in 50 cities. And one good result, you know, your question about can something be done? Absolutely, something can be done. We need to all work together. And in Danone, one of the studies that we have done in terms of nutrition intervention is that we have proven that we can improve stunting rate by 8.4% in 6 weeks with nutrition intervention, which is 4.3% better than the WHO numbers. We've also understand very much that this is multi-stakeholder. So we've done a joint collaboration with the West Java government. We signed an MOU where we look at multi-stakeholder approach in terms of nutrition intervention, in terms of education, working with the healthcare practitioners to improve the situation and to educate the moms. And if you allow me, we also work with schools, because at the end of the day, when the children are in schools, it's very important. So we have a program called Warung Anak Sehat, where we work with the canteen operators. We work with them to look at what are the healthy nutrition that you could serve in the school canteen, working with the canteen operators, but also with the teachers, with the parents, to educate why is nutrition so important? Because it has lifelong impact to the health of the child and the general intelligence of the child, and therefore the progress of a nation.
Yeah, I remember when I was going to school, I love all this goreng-goreng and the fries, and they're not nutritious. Since we talk about human capital development, and of course, half of that human resources would be women, and understand that Danone has campaigned a lot about women's role in human resource development. Can you share some insights on this decision, how can women develop their skills with all the stereotypes and challenges that they face in society?
Yes, it is. Again, let me share a few slides just to illustrate the point, right? Women is absolutely important. I mean, approximately half the workforce is women. All the panelists spoke a lot about enabling the workforce, bringing the workforce so that they can be productive and be productive for the nation. The situation with women is, may use the word, is drastic, because even if you look at data from World Health Economics, it will be 257 years before we can bring parity. And today, if you look at it, where's Indonesia? Indonesia has 50.7% of women participating in the workforce. The good news is half is participating, the other half is not. The bad news is the other half could be participating and they're not. And it's actually behind other Asian countries like Cambodia, Malaysia, some of you mentioned, and even Thailand. And if you look at equity index, women to men is 0.7 in terms of parity. which means women are not achieving parity. Then I think the other numbers to share is that why is that so, you know, gender gap? What is the situation here in Indonesia? Women are paid 20% less than men. There's 130% index men to women in terms of managerial level. Your question on Danone, what do we do? I think I'm very proud to share that at Danone, absolutely men and women are paid equal, the same for the roles that they do. And we're also happy that to say that 48% of all our workforce, of all our managers are actually women, and 53% of our directors are women. And one of the things that is, I think, absolutely important is, you know, when you speak of women and your question is about women and the workforce, we need to also recognize that women, first of all, we are mothers and wives, and therefore part of it is also the role in the family. So recognizing that the role of the woman in the family is very important to her, very precious, but also recognizing that that part of her while she's a professional at the same time. So having the right policies to support that she can succeed and continue to be in the workforce while fulfilling her role is important. So we have pro-parental policy in Danone here in Indonesia, as well as many parts of the world. We pay for 6 months fully paid maternity leave. So from the moment any women join us, they are entitled when needed, 6 months of fully paid maternity leave so that the men can support and play a role, 10 days of paternity leave. We also believe that for nutrition, for the future of Indonesia, breastfeeding is important. Breast milk is the best, 6 months exclusive, longer if the women can. So in any meetings, in any of our facilities, we have a lactating room and to provide for that.
Well, definitely you're leading by example.
Thank you.
I can share it in journalism. There are now more and more women than men, which is good because I think women make better journalists than men. Let's move to the next part, which is actually taking a question from the audience. I'd like to ask the MC, Gina. You have selected some of the questions that we want to pose to the panelists.
Okay, thank you, Pak Andy. Now we will enter to the question and answer session. I've sorted some questions from the participants of this afternoon's discussion. The panelists could answer directly to the questions. The first one is from an anonymous attendee. How could we actually accelerate the creation of quality competitive labor force given inequality access and opportunities in disadvantaged Eastern Indonesia? Maybe Bu Deni and Pak Tajudin could answer it, and other panelists could at some point too. Please.
Thank you. So I already posed that on the dashboard, but let me explain briefly about my opinion. Mm-hmm. So innovation, I believe that innovation should not wait until everybody or every district has access of telecom infrastructure. Because if that's the mindset that we have, I think electricity will be never provided in Indonesia, or any innovation will never take place. Innovation will always start small and then being, you know, escalated or being scaled up. We want to see some success, and then hopefully with that success will inspire more reforms, more provision of the infrastructure. So if we look at the survey, the number, not only the survey, this is actually the reality on the dashboard that we have at this moment in PMO dashboard. So the number of take-ups of pre-employment card is very high. Since April 11 to now, there are more than 12 million people registered. To be more precise, it's actually 14.97 million people access our website in order to enroll or register as the participants of a pre-employment card. So with that number, to some extent, we can say that pre-employment card actually has induced digital literacy of the society. And also, we should take notes that 85% of the recipients are young. So I hope that COVID actually blessing in disguise to speed up the digital transformation in the country. Because if we keep telling the students, the young people, that knowledge and only can be absorbed via classrooms or via teachers, I think this is no good. Because once people understand about internet, having some digital literacy, I believe that they will have limitless possibilities. So the way they register, the way they learn via online courses, I think that's transformative for themselves. So we should not go back to the 2.0 mode after the period of pandemic is over. I think we have to keep moving toward digital transformation at the higher level in the country in order to make sure that the young actually can learn and can sell or open up their possibilities beyond borders. So I think that's my opinion about digital transformation and also digital literacy infrastructure barriers that I understand that some people in Indonesia actually still have at this moment. But for people who live in the very remote areas, I think we should talk about the provision of basic infrastructures and also basic services like education, health, road, electricity, etc. And then let's start talking about the pre-employment card. I think there are a lot of basic stuffs that need to be catch up or provided in those regions.
Okay, maybe Pak Tajuddin would add some points, please.
Can you unmute, Pak? Prof? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Compared to East Asian and South Asian countries, Indonesia have competitiveness advantage in terms of human resource, at least until 2030. Indonesians have abundant young, menial labor force. However, we need to force them move on from the maybe situation that maybe now might be not favorable to develop their skill. So we need to develop, Indonesian need to develop a grand design and comprehensive first policy aim at generating full productive and fairly chosen employment and decent work for young people, especially that region or maybe some kabupaten, something like that, to force them follow the transition to work by involve in training center to get additional skill. And maybe the grand design should be emphasis on the effective integrations of young people into the world work. It means they have to have more hours to do skill practice in the workforce or in the labor market. So maybe government should develop kind of magang system, apprenticeship system. Maybe they ask private sector to give chance to young people to get new skills in their activities, in the firm activities. And then maybe government give incentive to the firm that open for magang or magang system for the young kid, young skill. No. Sorry, young people.
Okay.
And then I think it necessary to inform that design and implementations should based on update key or labor market indicators. So you have, you know, in local or kabupaten or district, sub-district need collaboration between government, public sector, and maybe private sector. Because if kabupaten of local, regional, something like that, develop kind of a system, it may be help young folk, labor force to have a, what call it, additional skill that it is need for instance labor market. I think is I can answer the general idea something like that, because there are many constraints, you know, in low level there, in rural level, you know. So public, especially government, should more, what call it, pay attention how to develop skill training, additional skill training in the low level. For example, Ministry of Labor Force now, they develop what's called it BLK communities on the low level. So this open opportunities for the young kid to get additional skill for entering labor market. I think it's something like that, what call it? Again, I want to say, nice to say, but not easy to implement, because there are many constraints, you know, yeah, in our countries, because, you know, we lot of different culture, different, yeah, social structure and something like that. Okay. So maybe if we have ideas to develop in local level, I think they will help them to get additional skill for entering labor market.
Okay, thank you, Pak Tajuddin and Ibu Deni. Now we have a second question from Julia Pangky to Pak Tajuddin and other speakers. Is it possible that manufacturers are not entering Indonesia because Indonesian workforce, work ethics and stability, because Indonesian laborers do rally more often than Vietnam or Cambodia? It's somewhat lower than those from either Vietnam or Cambodia. As such, many manufacturers are moving their business to those countries as their workforce are more efficient and less demonstration or protesting. Maybe we will begin with Pak Anton, maybe.
Yeah, I think this is, I mean, if we meet the investor, I mean, they are classic. Yeah, always they mention about that. But we must realize, but we are now, this is less competitiveness. I mean, fortunately, Vietnam is, the population is not so big. That's why they also have a problem, the shortage worker. I mean, to find 500 people is difficult. And then the problem, like already the explained in the beginning, that what mentioned is investment climate, and then especially law enforcement is, I mean, I cannot say not work, but it is not effective. I mean, yeah, if we cannot improve the kind of investment climate, it's difficult for us. We just talk about the quality of worker, but beside that, there are many things we must improve. We not talk only about minimum wages, because this is sometimes as a human, it's not nice we talk only the minimum wages. But what we concern is the cost of labor regulation. For example, severance payment in Indonesia, if somebody already worked 24 years up, yeah, you must pay 32 months, 32.4. You can imagine my friend have a shoe factory, he already exercised with 9,000 worker. If he stop business. How much he must pay severance payment? He calculate at that time 2 years ago is around 800 billion rupee. And then from where he can pay? He sell all the assets. If he sell all the assets, only get 600 billion rupee. And the 200 from where you get? And then for us who already in Indonesia, yeah, whatever we be will be, we cannot go to, because we already have a bank loan and then many responsibility. But for the newcomers, new investor, of course, they study about our law. Not only only complain about labor issue, but also inconsistency policy. About tax inconsistency, same problem. I just meet one Japanese group of businessmen, also same story. For example, our tax council, tax court. You can imagine we have same problem, we win. But in this year, we lost with the same case. That's why always this become, they confused for the investor. That's why I think with the omnibus law, we hope this is at least cannot solve 100%, but at least try to reduce. And then because the only way to solve our problem about the poverty and then another, the only way is give them job. No other way to, just subsidize. You cannot support for the whole year. For the people, give subsidize. And the on then, the second is how to establish TVET system and then make the our worker make more productive. This is the only way.
Okay, Pak Tajudin. Thank you, Pak Anton. Maybe Pak Tajudin would add something.
If I'm not wrong, I hear from BKPM. Now about 17 or 19, a firm or industries will come to Indonesia soon, later maybe in this year, because now government try to involve them and then to give them more, simple times to do the, surat izin. For example, in Batang, I hear that the government will provide land for them, and it has to come to regional, to kabupaten or to province to mengurus surat izin, and then BKPM will do it all. Then give them something, more easier. Because last time, mengurus surat izin take times. Sometimes they need 1 year or 10, or 1 year or maybe 10 year maybe, Now government try to attract the investor to come with give them more easy and try to, push the, constraint something time to mengurus surat izin and then everything that should be can short time to do but the Indonesian bureaucracy is kalau bisa dipersulit jangan dipermudah now government try to change the idiom give them kemudahan, so they will come to our country. And then maybe if this correct and this good information, maybe next year we have some, factory or industries come to Indonesia. Maybe. Then I think it's good news. But I don't know this is correct or not because I just hear from media. I just hear from television. Television is maybe give very nice news, but I don't know in reality. we wait for this kind of happy
news
information.
Okay. Okay, thank you Pak Tajudin, Pak Anton. Now a third question from Rusiana. Would it be possible to create a training center with the government as license with the working field or area or market in each university in Indonesia, even more specifically each faculty in that university? If this is possible, can this lead to competency-based curriculum in the future? Would you please explain in with the strength and opportunity, but also the weakness of that thought? Thank you. Maybe we can begin with Bu Deni, maybe, or Pak Tajudin, please.
Yeah, this is university, right? I think
yeah,
our government will now set up vocational, what call it, a dirjen, you know? The new, what call it, the new dirjen in Diknas, the vocational school, something like that. I hope they will have some ideas, collaborations between university and private sector. I think they now try to have some collaboration with a German in training center. Maybe then maybe university will have some some aid from government, Germany government, to set up this what call it training center in university. Last time I have went to my university, a Toyota will give Gajah Mada University digital machine. You know, Gajah Mada University last year, 2 years, they don't have digital system for machine equipment. And then Toyota give university digital machine through my friend, good friend, Pak Bob Azam. And now Gajah Mada University ask students to have a good practical in digital system. So they will, will help them to get job, because they already have some kind of skill doing in digital system, machine, something like that. I think we have to set up collaboration between university and private sector.
I would like to add some points to Pak Tajudin's answer. So I believe that to be sustainable and relevant, it should be demand driven. So we should not have like a uniform program in order to have a training center installed in each university or each faculty, because then we will repeat the same mistakes that we have done in the past. The second thing is that we have to make sure that every parties, the universities, the students, and also the business sectors see some binding incentives why they actually collaborate, why they need to collaborate to have training center installed in the university. Because otherwise, then the results or the outcome will not be like what we expected. So we should start with the question, what is it for the universities to have the training center? What is it for the students to have the training center? What is it for business to have the training center? Such that the training itself, again, is relevant. Without any relevance, then we only spend a lot of cash and money, state budget, without significant results.
Thank you, Bu Deni and Pak Tajudin. Maybe Pak Anton?
I want to add something. If we ask now, what we need now? We need skilled and trained worker. If the question is like that, and the answer is, first, we must, have a system. We not talk about piece by piece. I mean, training itself, and then school like this, like that. Yeah, it is good. I mean like this. If I have no experience, I came to Danone, maybe even without instructor, and then if I apply job to another company, maybe because experience 6 months there is okay. But what we need is system. System, I mean the people from Papua, if they follow the system, may guarantee if he or she come to Jakarta, he can get job with his competence certificate. That's why what we need now is we need to create the ecosystem, to build the ecosystem. And another is, if possible, to create TFEP law or legislation nationwide. And another, we need a respective nationwide synchronized certification system, because now we have what we call the institution who give certificate. We have 1,400 something,
NSP.
And then the business society will apa itu namanya Pak Tajudin yang bawa Pak
BNSP, BNSP.
Kunjung, ya, tapi BNSP, yang lembaga LLSP atau something like that itu.
Ya. LSP, and, LSP. Yeah.
And that's why we need a TFET body for Indonesia or whatever the name, but Committee Nasional Vokasi. In order to coordinate TFET in Indonesia, because you can imagine, for example, let's make it simple. In Germany, they only have what they call profession or occupation of profession, yeah, lebih clear. Only 326 now, before 328. And every profession, they have a profession law. I mean, every school and the factory must follow. But in Indonesia, I not understand until now because we follow Australia system, who competence. In Kadin, we discuss already have competence is more than 10,000 bodeni, 12,000 something like that. And then I ask how we can do with the 10,000 or 12,000 competence because this is more concentration and more complicated. That's why the government must choose. We want to follow competence or profession. For me, it's profession is better because why? One profession is they have must have several competence. For example, in Germany, they don't have what the name of Tukang Las welder, for the welder, because welder is including in the every profession or occupation. Make it easy. For example, flight engineer. One of the competence he must have is welder. But in here, welder is one competence. In Germany, they have a profession with minimum competence. I mean, make the people. That's why German is very clear. The government may guarantee to every citizen at least they have a minimum competence based on their survive in their future. Until now we still discussion, but hope soon government will choose national committee. I mean they have committee body or the TFET body for Indonesia and can consider about that.
Okay. Okay, very interesting take, Pak Anton. Now we also have a question for Ibu Koni. This is from Gutama Bahtiar. Having read news, articles, studies, reports on Indonesia 30%+ stunting rate, highest in Southeast Asia, correct me if I'm wrong, PISA scores, human capital index over the last few years, in the case of stunting concern, what are the major challenges and how to sort them out from economic, socio-cultural, and health standpoints? Any success story to share? Maybe Bukoni could elaborate more on this and other speakers could add some points too. Please, Bukoni.
Thank you for the question. Stunting is indeed high in Indonesia and it is a critical issue. And the thing about stunting is it is a complex issue. It is a complex issue which requires multi-stakeholder involvement. You cannot separate social education, economic, you cannot separate those to resolve stunting. The point to resolve stunting is that it requires collaboration, it requires partnership, it requires it requires an intervention into the ecosystem, which means that academia, healthcare, parents, the system, government, think tank, companies, all needs to be involved to resolve that issue on stunting. And I think there was somebody who asked the question as well about, you saw, what about mothers wearing, what about mothers' role in solving stunting and the culture? Absolutely, you know, we talk about building a strong house of Indonesia. If you want to build a strong house, the most important is nutrition. So therefore, understanding that nutrition is health. And health, having a good health, is the start of everything for the progress of the child and the future of this nation. So part of it is absolutely important, educating the child, even the teachers and the mother on the importance of nutrition, and that the first 1,000 days, if you don't have the right nutrition, if you do not do intervention, then you compromise the child, not only physical growth, but also general intelligence.
Thank you, Ibu Koni. We also have another question from the same person to Pak Anton specifically. In regard to training for professionals, citing World Bank report, private sector in the country ranks one of the lowest percentage in Southeast Asia for getting their employees trained. How business sees it, and to overcome this situation to enhance or improve the workforce learning and development? Please, Pak Anton.
Thank you, Gina. I already explained in the beginning, if we introspect ourselves, that's the weakness point of our society, business society, because they still seeing to train the people. Improve the quality of the people is high cost, but actually not, because finally the company can compete with another, and that's why when we visit Germany, and then we the Minister Müller, the Minister of International Cooperation, talk that when you talk about vocational, first you must change your mind. Mindset you must change. Mm-hmm. Yeah, instead of, for example, explain, like Toyota, they follow, not 100%, but they follow the German system. But actually, like Toyota, not necessary to follow Germany, because Toyota have their own culture. But even that, they try to follow. Then finally, when they realize they have what they call training system for 6 months, and also polytechnic. After they train the people, they already have several bats, maybe 10 bats. Finally, they realize that to recruit the people is more efficient, and finally, more cheaper, not in the money, but more effective through vocational system. That's why this is our job, in Kadin, how to change the philosophy. Because you cannot succeed in the long run without the high-ranking worker, the high quality. Read what the Ben Bernanke, the previously the Fed, mentioned about. No economy can succeed without a high quality workforce, particularly in an age of globalization and technical change. But frankly speaking, the problem from us, not many, for the big businessmen, and then have good network, they realize this, how important the people. But how about another? That's why, as I told in the beginning, the corruption and nepotism, this is very bad for us, make our international competitiveness become bad, because this is unfair trade. Now, as long as we cannot solve this problem, it is difficult.
For example, the company may be not easy to get the people because they can hijack the people, give salary better than from another company, and then this is not good. Better they teach the people, and then that the problem is become human capital. Because today we talk about human capital. I mean, this is not as a human resource. I mean, if we need people, we can hire, but we teach them. This is, our homework, and we together with Professor Tajuddin already work 1 or 2 years for that.
Okay. Another question for Ibu Deni from David of Budi Luhur University. Bu Deni explained that the Indonesian government is targeting significant economic growth so that Indonesia's GDP per capita could be in the same range as developed countries' GDP per capita by 2045. Please give us more explanation. What is Indonesia's target? Is it $12.5K or more? If the target is only $12.5K, I don't think that it will be enough to make Indonesia a developed country, considering the 2045 developed countries will be much higher. Yeah. Budeni, can you unmute? Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I also already answered the question. That's very good question. That's really good question. But I might not be like the competent person to answer the question. But I will say that a wise man says, if your dream doesn't scare you, then it isn't big enough. So we understand as an economist how hard it is to achieve that goal. To be a developed country in 2045. But I think the issue is not whether the goal is achievable or realistic or not, but it is more about inspire our nation, our people to work harder and run with faster pace. Then in 2045, we can all witness how far we can achieve. So if we set the target low, just to be realistic, I'm afraid Indonesia, we will run slower than when we should have. So I think the point is, we have to inspire our people and have a belief in ourselves that we can actually, run faster with our potentials, with collaboration internationally. Of course, collaboration is not only among the domestic parties, but also with the international community to run faster toward that goal.
Okay, thank you, Ibu Deni. That was our last question. It's already almost 5 p.m. I'm sorry. I hope the issues we have discussed here are also to be included as an input for the Human Capital Roadmap towards Indonesia's 2045 vision. Thank you. Thank you very much for all speakers and participants for the delightful discussions today in Jakpus Up Close. I apologize if I couldn't deliver all of your questions to the panelists due to the time constraints. We will also have another webinar coming up next week titled Land Without Farmers, Indonesia's Agricultural Conundrum. So make sure you're registered. Before we end the discussion today, I would like to invite all the panelists to take a photo together, please. I will count 1, 2, 3, cheers. Okay, beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Also, if you want the Jakarta Post to contribute more to public discourse, subscribe today on jakartapost.com/packages and don't forget to follow our social media, the Jakarta Post on Facebook, at Jakpost on Twitter, and at Jakpost Images on Instagram to get the latest updates. I'm Gina Galia. Stay safe, stay well. Thank you, and bye.
Thank you all.
Bye.